more about it. And Wally will talk to you about it and answer any questions that you have. So I've asked him to come in and share with us a little bit about it. He shared it maybe a couple of years ago now, last time, back when we were at the old Newman and Dunn office. And a lot of fascinating stuff. And I think every good buyer's agent should be suggesting this to their clients, should be at least educating them and then suggesting, hey, if you want to get a radon test, this is how to do it. I recommend it. Some people choose not to. I found some people do their own research and they say, no, I'm good. That's fine. That's their choice. But you as a buyer's agent, your responsibility is to protect your client and at least give them this recommendation. It's their choice to choose to do it or not. So, but anyway, so Wally, I'll let you take it over and then we'll go from there. Looks like you're presenting too. Cool.
So you do see that?
Yeah.
That was going to be my first question.
We can see it.
All right. That's much better than seeing me, I think.
We could see both if we could, depending on what we want to pick, but you're good.
All right. So, you know, we've been doing radon testing for 35 years now, and radon's second leading cause of lung cancer. It's a naturally occurring element that comes from the decay of uranium in the soil. And it's the leading cause of lung cancer nationally, except for cigarettes. In Central Virginia, about one out of every four homes that we test comes back high. And in Virginia, just come over to this Virginia Radon Law page. You've got to be certified. You have to be listed by NRSB, the National Radon Safety Board, or National Radon Proficiency Program in order to do that. If you don't have a listing, which just means you've taken some continuing education classes and passed a test. If they don't take the coursework, it's kind of like saying, well, I'm going to be a realtor, but I don't really feel like I should take any coursework. It's against the law. You can't do it. For a while, there was a lot of people doing that. And all you have to do is look them up on nrsb.org or nrpp.info. There's no penalty for doing it, you know, without it, which is bizarre, but that's just the hurdle we've got to clear at some point in the future where something's against the law. It seems like there should be some consequence for not doing it. So here we get back to it's a naturally occurring carcinogen, and it's not class B or C, it's class A carcinogen, meaning it's been documented to cause lung cancer in humans. And we've got it everywhere. You know, if we're outdoors, we're going to be measuring some. We're going to be measuring 0 to 0.5 picocuries per liter. If we're inside, we should be seeing typically 1 to 1.5 picocuries per liter. And if we're between 2 and 4 picocuries per liter, EPA says consider mitigation, which has been a real thorn in everybody's side involved with real estate. And 4 and above, we just say fix it. And yeah, the lung cancer documentation goes back to the 1940s, as you can see on this slide. Four, the way we like to reference the risk associated with that, four is roughly like smoking a half pack of cigarettes a day if you spend 75% of your time in the house. And that's the way EPA used to talk about the risk associated with it. And sometime in the 90s or early 2000s, they went away from the cigarette analogy because the press would get a hold of it and they would say EPA says four is like smoking a half pack of cigarettes a day. And it's no longer true at that point because they've eliminated that time factor. If you're exposed to it for 2 hours a day, is it still like smoking a half pack of cigarettes a day? No, it's based on 75% exposure. But what I like about it is that radon is a carcinogen that causes lung cancer and cigarettes are well documented to cause lung cancer. So if you're in a house that's 10 picocuries per liter, and I'd just like to round it to 5 and 10 because it's easier to do math on 5s and 10s. If you're in a house that's a 10 picocurie per liter home, which we find a couple of times a week, it's roughly like smoking a pack a day if you spend 75% of your time in the house. Or if you're like the average person that spends 30% of your time in the house, well, until coronavirus hit, then it's still like smoking about a half pack a day. But now with coronavirus and people spending so much more time in their house, and you know, normally we've seen people through the years begin to work more from home, as well as stay at home moms and retirees, then yeah, you're still going to have that half pack a day exposure equivalent at 4 picocuries per liter. And it's taken out about 22,000 Americans every year. So that's pretty significant that year in, year out, since we got started on this in the 80s, that radon is killing about 22,000 Americans annually. We've always said, you know, it's an invisible, odorless, colorless gas that you really can't see, taste, touch, or feel. This is called a cloud chamber. This is actually radon decaying in an alcohol vapor. And you can see how long these tracks are. When we get to about 45 or 50 seconds in this, you know, I'll try and jump it forward. There's the operator of the chamber is going to put his hand up against the side of it. So you get to see how long these different decays take. And they'll travel 2 or 3 inches within your lungs. And you can see some of them actually do like a chevron shape, where they do what's called a double decay. So they're actually decaying in your lungs twice. But there's the operator's thumb. You can see how long those tracks are compared to his hand. So the question becomes, can you see how that would interact with lung cell structure just by virtue of how far it travels while it's in your lungs? And it's a fairly high energy. And what we used to think back in the dawn of radon, when I got started in this in the 80s, was that when you have a radon decay, that it hits the radon hits a piece of lung cell structure and it damages it or it kills it. And what we found out subsequently is that Dr. Tom High of Columbia University proposed that when radon atoms decay, they obliterate, because they've got so much energy, they just obliterate the lung cell structure that they run into. And it's kind of like when you're playing pool, you break it and that lead ball transfers its energy to everything that's touching it. So all of a sudden you've got all this energy just bouncing around the table in a game of pool, or bouncing around in all the cells that are attached to the cell that's been hit. So you start off with many, many, many more damaged cells. Now let's get out of YouTube. I'm not sure how that happened. Okay. And this is a piece of silicon film. It's actually all these little spots are on a piece of silicon film that's about one inch by one centimeter is what it is. So you can see that at 228 days at 1 picocurie per liter, all of those little specks are those radon atoms decaying, and they're decaying with such energy that is a piece of film, and it's been damaged by the radon atoms decaying. And at 4 picocuries per liter, you can see it's a lot more, but still it's time, because this is only at 100 days. So it's time that really accumulates the damage, not as much the radon level. So here's a Virginia radon map, and the map is, you can see Powhatan, Goochland, Amelia, they're all in a zone 1 region. Zone 1 region meaning about a 50-50 chance of any particular home coming up with high radon. Now if you get out here to the east, you see that yellow is what's called a zone 3 region, and it's a lot less likelihood, but it doesn't mean that you won't find it. And when we're finding radon out there, the state guys would come back to me and say, are you sure your machines are right? So what I found a couple of years ago was this uranium map, and the uranium map shows former mining leases. You can see up towards the top center, and down to the bottom center is the Coles Hill deposit. That's the richest resource of uranium in the United States. And all that red is mineable quality uranium. So you can see where even off to the coastal plain out here in the Delmarva area, you've still got deposits of high uranium, which means you're gonna find high radon. It's more sporadic, but it's there. And it shows you that there's gonna be some high radon homes out that way. These are just different types of radon monitors. We use that 1027 in the middle. I've seen a lot of homeowners use the safety siren that's right next to it. All the radon monitors that are being used, there's safety checks that need to go along with those, you know, with using them, kind of like doing comps in real estate. And we'll get into that a little bit more, but these are just some different things that you'll see out there in the field that people are using to test for radon. This is just an example of a charcoal test kit that we use when we're doing apartments, condominiums, FBI Academy up in Quantico, retirement homes, places like that. They're just a lot cheaper and we can deploy a lot more of them without having to worry about if somebody's going to steal a $1,000 monitor. These things are maybe 15 bucks a piece. So if they disappear, it's not that big a deal. And again, more passive devices. They're all activated carbon. It's a coconut husk. And when they burn a coconut husk, it leaves just thousands and thousands of little pores in each granule of activated carbon. So in that larger device up to the upper left-hand corner, you can really have up to 3 miles of surface area for the radon to adsorb into. And this is just a an example of a deployment. We have our TV trays that we put these things on. It's a sun nuclear device. We hang our festive yellow signs all around, let people know that there's a test in progress, and they'll need to leave windows and doors closed except for coming and going and run heating and air conditioning normally. And again, this is the same device that we use. It's just the next step up. It holds more data. They say you can run 3 tests end to end, which to me is kind of pointless because you guys want your information when I'm done with the test. So it doesn't do me any good to be able to accumulate 3 tests worth of data. And this one is just got more bells and whistles, which to me means more things that can break. And this is a passive device. Those couple of devices that we showed, the silicon film with all the spots on it, that's where the silicon film resides inside of these containers. So it's got a filter, as you can see on the device on the left, that keeps out particulate, because if you got smokers in a house, then you can actually have radioactive decay coming from the cigarettes. So you don't want to have that radioactive decay on your test devices. So the filter allows radon as a gas to pass through. And then as it begins decaying, it leaves those tracks all over that film that we saw earlier. And these are EPIRMs. Somebody figured out how to charge those discs at the bottom of the screen. They're Teflon, and they have been charged with 750 volts. And when the radon decays, it discharges the voltage. So it's really interesting way to test. It's pretty doggone accurate, but that box that they've got in the background, I had a home inspector one time that showed me one of those boxes that was zip tied to a doorknob. He took a picture of it, sent it to me, but then he took a picture of the door and the door was in the backyard. So there's not much security with those things. With our devices, when they become unplugged, it tells us what time and when, or what time and for how long. So here's one of the things that we've been really trying to hurdle for years. When we first got into this, it was thought by many that crawl space homes would not have high radon. And what we found subsequently was any home can have elevated radon levels. It's just a matter of how much uranium is in the soil below a house. So for that reason, the Surgeon General and the World Health Organization say that all homes should be tested. And yeah, we're a member of the World Health Organization. Interesting thing about them is that they say fix it at 2.7 picocuries per liter, where we say fix it at 4. And pretty much any home can be fixed through a process called mitigation remediation. And as I kind of alluded to earlier, in Central Virginia, about 25% of the homes we've tested have radon levels above 4. And 49% of the ones that we test that are high are actually on crawl space. The highest home we ever had was out in Chesterfield County, Chippenham, and Belmont Road was 253 picocuries per liter. That's like smoking about 25 packs of cigarettes a day if you spend 75% of your time in the house, and maybe only 12 packs a day if you're home 30% of your time. And again, here's that map, that radon map. So it shows much closer up. Petersburg, Dinwiddie, Chesterfield, Colonial Heights, Goochland, all in red. So they're all really high potential. And that isn't limited to just radon and air. We've had plenty of radon and water from our wells that come back high too. And that's not just our own personal drilled wells or bored wells. That's also community wells. And this house is kind of like a traditional tri-level that you see plenty of in Central Virginia. You can see there's a crawl space in the middle. There's a basement to the right and a garage slab all the way to the far left. And for houses like this, we need to use more than one monitor because each of those areas can have its own specific radon level because it's really covering its own piece of ground. We found plenty of cases like this where the basement is lower than the area above the crawl space. And this is kind of a cutaway example of really two different types of mitigation systems. In our area, the mitigators are largely well-versed enough to where they would connect all of these systems together. So the system on the right, you can see, is actually pulling radon from below a vapor barrier and venting it to outside with a fan and then venting it to above the roof line. Historically in Central Virginia, the mitigators have tried to do this interior approach, although as the competition heats up, they try and bring the price down. So that system to the left is an interior installed system. And they cost a little bit more to install, but it's better for the mitigation system and it's better for the aesthetics of the house. And this is what a crawl space can look like after you've done mitigation. This mitigator runs a really high-end system. That's a cross-woven polymer membrane that's sealed off to the sidewalls as well as to the piers. There's drain tile below that vapor barrier so that when they attach the PVC piping into the fan and vent it to above the roofline, it's pulling radon from below that vapor barrier all around underneath the house. And that is just so much more attractive to look at than a traditional crawl space with dirt or torn up poly or back in the days of when they started using tar paper. And you see to the bottom left where that first arrow is, there's that bump underneath the poly and that's where the drain tile goes. And the arrows are merely indicating the airflow direction. So this one has a basement. So that's where that arrow to the right is actually pulling from the basement as well as from the crawl space. And then the arrow to our left is going up and into a wall cavity or else into a garage. And here's a typical basement system. This one just vents up and goes to outside. These things do a great job of dehumidifying a basement too because they're pulling radon, but they're pulling mold, mildew, and moisture out as well. It's gonna affect each house a little bit differently, just like with us. You know, if we get a bee sting, some people are highly allergic, some people are a little bit allergic, and some people are like, get that thing off of me. But there's a U-tube in that middle arrow that you can see it's a little bit different. The columns are a little bit different. That just shows that the fan is working. It doesn't say that that's the radon level. There's a label next to the U-tube that shows the system installer. They need to put their name and date that system was installed. And you can see at the top, this thing is nicely fastened to the wall with some steel strapping. As it passes to the right, it actually winds up going outside of the house. This is another component of that system that we looked at a minute ago, the crawl space. This is where that piping comes up out of the basement, out of the crawl space, into the garage. And then at the top of the picture, you can see there's a little fire collar because there's finished space up there. So if you have a fire in the garage, you don't want it to go into the rest of the house. And again, there's nice steel strapping to keep that thing secure. And there's so much stuff going on in that garage that you don't even notice that mitigation system. It's next to the whole house back, the Sub-Zero garage beer fridge. That's a pretty nice beer fridge. And here's what your typical fan and switch setup will look like. The switch should be within sight of the radon fan, and that radon fan is obviously in the attic, just venting straight out through the roof. So it's well protected from the weather. And that's what it looks like on the outside. As it comes out of the house, it just vents into the atmosphere. And unless you know what you're looking at, it doesn't hinder the aesthetic quality of the house at all. And this is an exterior application. The switch is right there next to the fan. This is on the far side of the house away from the driveway. So unless you want to have a party and show all your neighbors your radon fan and radon system, nobody's ever going to see it. And this is that same house, and it's just vented to above the roof line. You can see it's more than 10 feet away from the window at the lower left. And any windows that are up on that second floor are well away from it. And it has to vent to above the roof line so that it doesn't stand a chance of being re-entrained. or brought back into the house, in other words. When we get a call to do a post-mitigation system inspection, we're not just testing the house, we're looking at the mitigation system as well. So this is an example of a system that a mitigator put in. It's a national group, and I have no idea why they do this. You can see that they've got exposed earth in that upper left-hand corner. How can a radon fan pull air when it's not sealed to the ground? I mean, it can pull air, but it can't pull it from below the vapor barrier. It's kind of like a straw with a pinhole in it. If the straw has that pinhole leak, you can get a lot of air, but not much of your drink. And same thing stands true with the vapor barrier. It's designed to be sealed tight up against the walls so that you're pulling air from the soil, not from the crawl space. And you can see the vapor barrier was actually coming down all over the place. They use this stuff called acoustical caulking, and it just is not the right thing to use. And this is why you want to have a post-mitigation inspection once you've had a house mitigated, just to make sure that everything is installed properly. And this is some more of the components, and we detail this. It takes us probably half an hour to get all these pictures in and put our narrative and explain what's wrong with it. You can see the breaker box wasn't labeled. In the upper left-hand corner, you can see where the pipe passes through the wall, where they did manage to seal off around there, but they really, instead of drilling a hole, they just kind of blasted a hole through the center block wall. And how well can mitigation systems work? We've had them homes that were over 250 picocuries per liter, and it brought it down to below one afterwards. And because they're pulling soil gas, they don't discriminate as to which soil gases they're pulling. They can reduce mold, mildew, and moisture as well. So to me, that's almost as big a bang for your buck as the radon mitigation system. We had a guy in downtown that he was an actuary of when we tested his house. He was on Kensington Avenue, and he had a nice office and living room and a bedroom down in his basement. And he told me the mitigation system was going to start paying him back in about a year and a half to 3 years. And what he had done is figured out how much heat his dehumidifier was putting into the air that the radon system wasn't going to do. You know, it wasn't going to generate heat when he's trying to cool that space. The dehumidifier is merely pulling air or moisture out of the air that's already there, whereas the radon mitigation system doesn't allow it to get into the air. It's actually pulling it out before. So that makes it easier for the HVAC system to operate because it's not trying to strip all that moisture out of the air. So again, another huge benefit to have the mitigation system in the house. And we actually test well water, and you can see all this gear to the lower left is the paraphernalia that I have to use. We take off the aerator and install, we unscrew the aerator, we take it and install this into the faucet, and then add this onto the outside of this, and then we fill the bottle. So what's going on there is this has a piece of filter paper in it so that it will not be pulling in any other contaminants, organic or otherwise. It's just strictly taking the water and passing it through and taking any kind of particulate out. We fill this, so it's a very, very slow process. It just doesn't wind up agitating the water, which would outgas it. Whoops, yeah, we're gonna go past that because that's a couple of minutes. But this is what a radon mitigation system in water looks like. You can see it's just bubbling the water furiously. I'm gonna try and get through. Oh, come on. There we go. And that's what a tank looks like. I don't know why we got this here. Go away. This is what an aerator system looks like. It's just a tank with four chambers in it, and the water is bubbled furiously. And there's a chamber at the top of the tank that allows for the radon to collect, and then it's vented to overboard. And you can see this pipe up here is actually the exhaust. Nope, this one right here is actually the exhaust for the system. So it's venting radon and water to outside. Here we go. It gets a little noisy. So this is how furiously it's boiling. It's blowing bubbles through it. So now we're down to where a lot of people have gotten into radon and they got certified, but it's not the end all. There's still a lot of things that they need to know. And they're told in their coursework, but nobody's standing over them to make sure that they're doing what they're supposed to be doing. And we finally distilled it down to three questions that people could ask of anybody offering to do a radon test to make sure that they are, in fact, doing what they're supposed to be doing. If all three questions aren't answered right, it's kind of like you've got a three-legged table and you pull one of the legs out. You know, as long as it's three legs, it's fine. As soon as you pull that one leg out, it just collapses under its own weight. First off, the person's got to be listed. They've got to be certified. And these are the different groups that do that certification, NRSB and NRPP. The monitors have to be calibrated annually. Obviously, I put this together a little while ago, a couple of years ago now. And this is a sticker from Bowser Warner that just shows what the calibration dates are. Usually, you can find it on the back or the side of a monitor. And there's a certificate that goes with that. So you can ask the person, if you don't see the sticker, can I see your calibration certificate? Just like you can ask them for their NRSB or NRPP identification. And is there a control chart? Control charts are like comps. Every 10th time we use a monitor, we use two monitors with it. And we intercompare the data sets, and that gives us our average, the fine green line down the middle. And we look to see how far off of the average each of the monitors are at the end of that 10th test. So that gives us what's called a relative percent difference. And you can see every once in a while, they'll bounce out and they'll be either really, really low or really, really high. And that's why it's so important to know what that relative percent difference is. If you don't have control charts, you're just guessing. You no more should do that if you're running a radon business than if you're a realtor. You don't go out there and just say, well, I think that house is worth $375,000 standalone without considering any of the rest of the market around it. You've got to look at like type homes. And in our case, we've got to look at like type monitors and intercompare them. And you've got to do it continually, because a year is like a really long time for a radon monitor to bounce around in the back of a pickup truck or the back of my little Honda Element and not expect it to have deviations. And this way you catch monitors as they break, and we do. And this is the report that we actually issue. So it shows that this monitor that was in the dining room, living room, has its pair down here, the QA monitor, and one was at 2.3, one was at 2.5, so they're within 8.3%. So they're telling you the same thing, that that monitor is really doing well. So it gives me a little vote of confidence when I send out the report that I know that the information is right. And this is, we had to build software to start chasing down these things, control charts and calibration certificates. And you can see this is the software that we built. It shows where the monitors are, you know, are they available, or are they being calibrated? There's information button all the way to the right where we can look at it. And if it's had problems, I can actually see what the problems were and when. It shows how many times each monitor has been used, how many times it's been used since its last calibration date. So we have a ton of information that we built into our software to help us run our business. And some of the home inspectors are getting savvy to the fact that you're going to ask them for a control chart, but they don't really know if it's a control chart or control log. And they'll make stuff up that makes it look like they're doing it, but in this case, they're not. This is what the guy called a control log, and he's one of our local big inspectors. You can see the readings on this thing. He's got enough of them that are high that you want to document, and on this blue one, it says his side-by-side number, and there's a monitor number, but there's no test results. So there's no way of knowing, is that monitor right or wrong? It just says that he put one there, and I'm not entirely sure that he did, because if he did, wouldn't he have the test results there? And what's a little bit scarier is that 40% of those things come back high in the first 10, and then after that, if you combine all of that data into it, about 60% of the radon tests that monitor kicked out were elevated. They needed to be mitigated, which is higher than normal for that broader region. He's got those tests all over the place, whether in, you know, Henrico, Glen Allen, Midlothian, Bonaire, So it should be really, you know, 25 to maybe 40%, but not 60%. And this is just how, this is the exercise, the math that we have to use that's in the background of our computer program showing what our control charts, how they're built. And this is a different control chart. It's the same thing, but this is a control chart for numbers that are less than four. And because the numbers, the radon levels are so small, it says that we're having a hard time measuring it because there's not enough there. So you expect to see a little bit bigger deviation when the radon levels are below four, particularly when they get to below two. I mean, if you have a 0.2 and a 0.8, statistically, that's a huge difference. But what it's telling you is that there's not enough radon there to measure accurately. Having said that, we still see numbers that are exactly the same, you know, radon levels that are exactly the same on both monitors frequently. So with the three questions, you know, kind of put you in the driver's seat. So when somebody sends you a test on one of your listings, you can ask them, is the person that did the test certified? May I see their certification? Is that monitor calibrated? You know, can I see a copy of your calibration certificate for that monitor? And can I see a control chart for that monitor? Because each monitor has to have its own control chart. If they can't answer any or even one of those questions correctly, it just means they're guessing. And if you're dealing with something that's the number two cause of lung cancer nationally, it seems like it's a really good idea to make sure these guys are doing the job right. And NRPP and NRSB, this is NRPP, they all say you've got to have supporting documentation. And supporting documentation means you got to have a QAQC plan in force and have control charts in order to have that QAQC plan. And this is NRPP and this is NRSB. And they both say you got to have a quality assurance plan. If you don't have it, you're just guessing. And here's how to find Ryan Parrish, runs our state radon program. NRPP.info, NRSB.org are the two groups that are credentialing agencies. They're not licensing boards, but they are credentialing agencies. And that was the end.
Cool. Thanks, man.
Too much stuff on the screen there.
That's good. So we got 18 people in here. Right now, do you guys have any questions for Wally? Any thoughts, questions, or anything you wanted to ask the radon expert today?
I do have a question. What happens if a listing gets a radon inspection, it comes back high, and then we ask for those logs, and they haven't, you know, one of those legs is missing out from under that table? You know, what can we do to protect our clients in a situation like that?
I mean, it's me personally, but I would just toss out the information and you can call Ryan Parrish. He's our state radon program director. And that's pretty much what he's going to tell you is that if they don't have the correct documentation, then how can you put any faith in the test?
Okay, cool.
Yeah. I mean, so we can use that information when representing our sellers. It's the same thing, you know, we battle over what's a defect and what's not, and was it a credible inspection or, you know, finding or whatever. And that's a battle that we make all the time. So, you know, this definitely gives us another tool to battle that with. I've wondered, Wally, I don't know if you have a theory on this, why it's radon is not regulated like something like lead paint as far as, you know, disclosures go. I mean, you're talking about a house you found with 250 PCI or L or whatever it is. And to me, like, if that's not mitigated, you're basically the person moving in there is just, it's like a death sentence if you're there long enough. I mean, why don't you think that's regulated like lead paint is?
You know, I've been at the General Assembly for the last 3 years battling that issue. I think that there should be a licensure program. I think that there should be disclosure to homeowners where they're given a package the same way that they are for lead paint.
Yeah.
And we get a lot of pushback from a couple of big lobbying groups that you can imagine who they might be, that they don't want the specter of radon because it's a buyer beware state. They want people to figure it out on their own. They don't want the realtors to be obligated to tell them, you know, what it is, where it comes from, what it does. And it's really as simple as that. If they got a one-page document that said, this is what radon is, this is what it does, this is where it comes from. Do you want to test your house for radon? Check yes here if you do. Check yes if you, check no if you don't, and sign it here. And there's just been a lot of pushback from the General Assembly. I think this July, there's going to be some notification required come out of a bill that I was pushing through last year. So it's a long, slow process to get that changed, and I've been working on it for years. It's an expensive process because most of the people that are doing radon testing and mitigation don't want any kind of legal recourse for anybody to come back on them. So the whole licensure disclosure thing is got two different groups of people, well, three different groups of people that are dead set against it. And again, two of them have huge lobbying groups, and the inspectors don't have a huge lobbying group, but they do have a say in it.
Yeah. I get that. I mean, I'm sure the Virginia Association of Realtors is, you know, wants less liability on the agents. And But to me, even if there's like a disclosure, it protects the agents, you know, a little bit. If the buyer signs something, it's just like, you know, they have in our contracts, do you want a home warranty? Do you not want a home warranty? And you have to check yes or check no. You know, it's like you have to make a decision. And really, it's there to protect us as realtors, in my opinion, because, you know, you go back to the, you know, the heat pump goes out and they say, well, nobody ever told me about a home warranty. I'm going to sue you, Mr. Realtor. And you go back, no, on the contract, actually, you checked a box that said you didn't want one, you know. So it's just weird to me that radon, to me, it seems like as much as it can be a potential problem, that it's not even nationally regulated, you know. I feel like it. Something they should be, but anyway.
I think you're right. That's the same information that I get from most of the realtors that we deal with, is that it helps them to protect their own business as well as their clients if they have the information and it's already mandated to be given to the buyers.
Yeah.
Then it helps reduce the liability on the realtor.
Yeah. Kat, did you have a question? You're unmuting.
Yes, I have a question. Sorry, I was logged out on accident.
Oh, you're good.
With new construction, after the home is finished, is there a certain amount of time that makes sense to wait before testing for radon? Because if you think about it, when the home is under construction, like, things aren't really closed up and working the way they would afterwards, so like maybe the results would be different if not everything's sealed up the way it's going to be sealed up while you're living there.
The house that I'm leaving as we speak was a new construction house. Mm-hmm. Over in Goodwood, and one of the new subdivisions over there, and it came back high. The radon, because it's a gas, it comes into the environment almost immediately. So it's kind of like turning a faucet off and on. As long as you get the house with closed house conditions, meaning windows and doors are closed except for coming and going, it should give you a pretty decent representation of what's going on. We've had brand new construction homes that hit 50 picocuries per liter within an hour.
Wow.
So you got to have the HVAC system, I'm sure, installed and running and all that stuff. Sealed up, yeah. House sealed up, insulation and all that, yeah.
It should be functioning just like it would if you were living in it, with the exception that nobody's actually living there yet. Okay. And we like to do those things on Friday afternoon and finish them up on Monday morning.
Yeah.
But that way we've got a lot less chance of, you know, a bunch of workers being in a house.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
It's going to be mayhem.
Cool. All right. We appreciate your time, man. Thank you. Oh, Betsy, do you have a question? Do you have a quick question?
Yeah, I was just wondering where y'all are located in your ideal areas to work in, and then what areas begin to have the travel fees? I know some areas are farther out than others.
Yeah, that's a question that's really left to Lisa. Like, we had one that came in today for Blackstone, and you know, that's not really close to anywhere, and except for our office, but we don't know where we're going to have to go next. So I guess a good rule of thumb is if it's like 30, 45 minutes from city center, then it's probably not going to be any travel. It's when it gets into where it's like 45 minutes from any place, then it's going to take some travel. At least it calculates that as the jobs come in, because it's just kind of tough to grasp. Luckily now there's two of us, and with enough business, a lot of times the travel is greatly reduced because we'll have more than one job in an area, even though it is an outlying area. We try to be fair about it, but if I've got to do 4 hours of driving, that's three more jobs that I can't get to.
Yeah, I mean, your work, I feel like, is your business model is based off of giving a good price because you can get in and get out quickly. And like you said, if you have to drive a long ways, that eliminates certain jobs you cannot get to. Try to get it. All righty. Cool, man. Well, I'm sure you're busy. We appreciate your time. Thank you. If you guys need to get in touch with Wally, they're on our vendor list. But you got a good website, Wally?
Yeah, radonease.com.
Radonease.com. Check it out. You can schedule. They're really good.
Yeah, all the reports come through radonreporting.com. There's actually a tool in there. It's under construction and has been for quite some time, but there's actually a map that you can go into that will show some area radon. And there's a lot of areas that we haven't tested, so that's at radonreporting.com. So if you get an area that doesn't have any high radon levels, if you look at it, it probably means that it hasn't been tested.
RadonReporting.com. Okay, cool. Let's check it out. Cool, man. Sounds good. We'll let you go. I know you're busy, and we'll close out our meeting. Appreciate you joining us. Thank you, Wally.
Thank you all very much. Look forward to seeing you out there. Stay safe. All right.
All right. You guys still there? Let's see if I can.
I am. I'm going to stop the recording now, unless you want to keep recording.
Okay. Yeah.